Karbir was a total surprise. Never ever in our future we are going to give that chance. So that the pride of the country was restored because of the sacrifice of the young officer. You know, people have given blood to ensure that we still put the prestige and country of our country at the top. But we should not allow this situation to come again, and you know, stay alert and ready for any such situation in future.
In February 1999, when the then Indian Prime Minister Atal Bihari Vajpayee was planning to roll out the historic bus service to Lahore back in Pakistan, his counterpart Nawaz Sharif was being taken for a ride by his own army chief, General Parvez Musharraf. A treacherous plan was in the works. Even before the ink on the Lahore Declaration had dried, Islamabad's deceitful ploy had started revealing itself on the heights of Kargil along the line of control. General Parvez Musharraf may not have accepted that the heavily armed intruders were Pakistani soldiers, but the war had already begun for India. In May 1999, India launched Operation Vijay to recapture the posts in the Kargil sector from the Pakistan Army. Captain Akhilesh Saxena was posted in Kargil just weeks after he got married. But nothing could deter this brave captain, who was an artillery officer attached with the 2 Rajputana rifles during the Kargil war. Captain Akhilesh Saxena and his men successfully went about recapturing Tololing, the Hump and Three Pimples Heights. During the war, Captain Akhilesh Saxena got injured by the enemy bullets and was admitted at the base hospital, Delhi Cantonment, for around a year. As the nation celebrates the Kargil Vijay Diwas on July 26, Captain Akhilesh Saxena, who is a living example of sheer grit, passion, determination and commitment, recounts his days on the battlefield in this exclusive conversation with Asianet Newsable.
Posted at the Kargil battlefield just weeks after getting married. What were your initial thoughts when the call of duty came?
So being a Fauji, I think it's always gives a sense of pride, you know, when you are being called for the war or warlike situation, right? The uniform you are wearing, you know, you always... So I was a little excited to get this posting because I was in a peace area and I was getting a chance to go into a warlike situation and, you know, serve for the country. That's a real thing which we kind of, you know, got trained and we are wearing our uniform. Yeah, I was little kind of had some anxiety and little this thing for my wife because she was from a total civil background. Just came to armed forces as a newlywed wife just few days back. We have not even unpacked our luggage, right? We have not even shifted to our house. We were still in the guest house and we were planning to shift in next few days and the call of duty came. So I was just thinking how she is going to cope up, and you know, I was just trying to talk to her and all. But what I realized, she was a brave girl, like she understood it. And she told me, no, don't worry. I understand. For a Fauji, you just go ahead and do your duty and I will wait for you. In fact, she understood that, you know, for a Fauji, the first thing is, the prestige and honor of the nation always come first. His jawans, his troops, his comrades comes next. And his own comfort, safety and his family man's and he himself comes at the last. So I think, you know, our choices are very clear in life. So there is no conflict, there is no dilemma. So yes, I was little kind of thing for my wife, but otherwise I was quite excited to, you know, go for this call of duty and prove myself in the most difficult conditions.
Captain, during the Kargil war, you and your troops successfully captured Tololing, the Hump and Three Pimples Peak. Could you narrate the entire episode?
Yeah, so just to tell you, when we reached that place, Kargil, situation was really difficult, right? In fact, you know, enemy was sitting on top and they were having all the equipments. They were also looking at us, you know, sitting on top, and as we are moving up, they are firing at will. The temperature was minus 28 to minus 42 degrees centigrade. It's difficult to even breathe. So we were not ready for this kind of attack. So we were not having all the equipments. Second thing, enemy has just come very close to the NH1. NH1 is the highway which connects, you know, starting from Srinagar till Leh Ladakh. And this highway is also called Neck of India because the entire supply to Leh Ladakh region goes through this highway. And if somehow you are able to block this highway, you can stop all the supply, and during winter months you can isolate entire Leh Ladakh region and capture it, right? So from a strategic point of view, this is very, very important highway. You know, hundreds and thousands of trucks goes during summertime, you know, carrying all these stockings, food, ration, ammunition. But at that time, enemy was able to stop it because he was just sitting on top and he could fire it at his will. So there was nothing possible. And when we reached the attack, 2-3 attacks were not successful on Tolo Link because, you know, there was a cliff of nearly 85 degrees and there was no cover. In fact, the peaks in Kargil and Daraz sector, they do not have any trees, vegetation, and also that you can take cover. So enemy can see you. And anyone who is sitting at 20, you know, on top is 20 times more powerful. So we were in like of, you know, we had all the disadvantage. So anyway, from the this task was given to 2 Rajputana rifle, and I was also kind of controlling the fire plan for the entire Tolo Link. There were many Bofors gun then we started to use in this particular attack, and you know, we were determined that we will win this. In fact, we decided that we will win or we will not come back. Many of us has written letters to our near and dear. We have written letters to our family that if we don't come back, like this is our last letter we are writing to them. So this was a difficult attack, and on 12th June we started attacking Tolo Link. We did not carry any food, anything in our packs. We have just kept the ammunition, arms, bombs, grenades, because see, sometime we will survive if food is not there for 2-3 days, but we cannot be short of supply for arms and ammunition. And this battle continued for entire day and night. And on 13 June, we could reach at the top. We were in a difficult situation. Some of us were hit by bullets. Some of my colleagues, Major Vivek Gupta, made the supreme sacrifice. But after a lot of struggle and continuous attack, and after making this sacrifice, we could capture this peak. And after this peak, you know, I participated as a forward observation officer with Hump Area, which was the next peak. We captured this also. And then I was given some rest and retreat because we were continuously fighting on top of the hills and without any proper food, without any sleep. You know, it's a humanly impossible mission, but we are determined that we will get it. My final attack and third attack was on 28 June, and this was for 3 Pimples area. And in fact, we were again with 2 Rajputana rifles. So when we reach very close to enemy, that time while attacking and fighting with the enemy, I got injured, hit by enemy artillery shelling and enemy firing, and you know, was bleeding badly. But I didn't tell my jawans and my, you know, buddy, because once they come to know that, you know, we are injured, officer is injured, right? The motivation of jawan may not be there. So we just kept quiet and we kept fighting. But I lost so much of blood during this time, right? It was difficult to survive. Even most of the officers and jawan lost their life because of the blood loss. But finally, we could get, you know, from there, I started putting some bandage on my hand, put it on top of my head and started walking back. It took nearly 8 hours to get the first medical aid. And it's just a, you know, miracle or that I'm still sitting here, survived and talking to you all today.
Right, Captain, absolutely true. Hats off to the armed forces, given the situation that you were explaining. But, you know, Captain, I wanted to understand what, according to you, are some of the major lessons that, you know, the armed forces learned, and how far do you think have they been implemented?
Okay. So I think it was a huge lessons for us during Kargil war, because one, we cannot take enemy for granted, right? He's capable of doing anything. So one, leave nothing to chance, right? That there was a lot of scenario planning which is being done and all, but obviously we have not thought that this can be one of the route of attack kind of thing. So second, we have now started occupying all these peaks. You know, we were leaving it unoccupied and Pakistan was also leaving it unoccupied. But then they started planning a strategy and they ensured that, you know, these peaks were captured. once somebody captured these peaks, then he becomes 20 times more powerful. So now today also, this was another lesson that we cannot leave our peak unoccupied. So right now also, temperature goes up to, you know, minus 42 degrees, but there are jawans who are staying on these peaks every day and night. It's very difficult even surviving there, right? Both in Siachen and all these top of these peaks. But that's what we are doing right now. Now, there's a lot of surveillance we have started, because see what happened. Earlier also, we were having surveillance, but the surveillance was to detect the large movement of army, right? They may not detect one or two guys. They may be just, you know, they're locals also. Pakistan used this strategy very effectively. They have sent their troop in a small group of 2 to 3 to maximum 4, and that too totally in the white clothes, right? So these movements were not detected, and they were able to, you know, capture these peaks by sending thousands of their jawans. So we become aware of this. So now this huge surveillance and every movement is being detected. So some of these things. Second is the guns. Initially, we were not having the heavy guns like Bofors and all in that area. No, there were only limited number of artillery presence. But then now we are having a good artillery presence in this area, just to ensure that, you know, they are able to react quickly, respond back to enemy, and, you know, did not give them any first mover advantage kind of thing. So all these things we have started taking for this. There are costs we are paying, right? Our jawan is still there on these peaks. But this is the cost we are paying. And we have taken all these lessons from Kargil war. There was a full reports on the recommendation that these lessons which need to be learned from the war. And we are just going through this.
Captain, it's been 22 years now since the war took place, and you know, the situation along the border, the Indo-Pak border, continues to remain volatile.
Yeah.
You know, do you ever think, firstly, that Pakistan would somewhere, you know, mend its ways, at least the Pakistan army, do you think it would mend its ways? And secondly, I also wanted to ask you that how far do you think technology is now playing a role in these kind of border-like situations?
Yeah, all right. So first I will give you the answer of second question. So now technology is becoming more and more important, right? In last 22 years, there are huge technological upgrades, both on the surveillance, both on your attacking capability, both on your defending capability, the kind of equipment now you have. See, when we were going for this attack, our bulletproof jacket was more than 16 to 20 kg, right? Wearing this and climbing up and running to attack the enemy was nearly impossible. Now we have got very good equipment, both in terms of guns, in terms of, you know, our night vision devices, right? Now there are 100% improvement devices. But issue is, whenever there's an improvement on your side, there's improvement on enemy side also. So both have upgraded, but both are still at the equal level, right? So I'm saying, in terms of comparative advantage, you will not get this advantage, because your enemy is also upgrading, moving up and asking for these equipment, right? So we are still on the same page. Now coming back to, you know, from the Pakistan side. See, on the Pakistan side, it's like, you know, for they do not have a real democracy in place. And in Pakistan, if you just want to rule, the anti-India agenda is the best agenda to do, right? So what they do, they will keep saying something like, you know, India is doing this, India is so, just to ensure that they stay in power. So I don't think at any time, you know, where we can say that we will have no disturbance from the side of Pakistan. That has to be there, because that's a question of their survival, right? How do they survive? Both their army and their whatever is the elected, or I say kind of semi-elected government, they will always talk about anti-India just to keep, you know, their population to their side. The second factor is China factor. China definitely want to become a superpower in this area. They want to be a regional power. To do this, they want to keep India engaged in these, you know, regional disturbances. So they will do something themselves, and they will ensure that Pakistan is keeping this proxy war in Kashmir in form of, you know, terrorism. And all the border, there is always some movement, because so that, you know, India will be engaged all this. If you really see, India has emerged as a very, very powerful country in last few years, right? So obviously, their main worries of China is just to keep India engaged with Pakistan, so that, you know, China can have a status as at least superpower that they want to do. So I think we have to continuously guard our border. You are seeing what's happening in Leh Ladakh, right? So we cannot be complacent at any particular time, and we need to ensure that we are using technology to our advantage. Like, Indians are very good in technology, and now we are bringing more and more technology in our defense capabilities also. But the fact is, we will have to remain continuous engagement at both the borders, both at the China side and Pakistan, and we have to be remain alert for any possible situation which they might create, right? Kargil was a total surprise. Never ever in our future we are going to give that chance, so that the pride of the country was restored because of the sacrifice of the young officer. You know, people have given blood to ensure that we still put the prestige and country of our country at the top. But we should not allow this situation to come again, and you know, stay alert and ready for any such situation in future.
Captain, very well put and very well said. I wanted to ask you, how has life changed for you personally ever since, you know, the Kargil war? How has it changed for you ever since then?
Oh, so I think it's a huge change. It has gone through 180 degree change. So in fact, as I told you, I got badly injured in my last attack, and I was in hospital for a very long time, undergo 3 major operations, you know, and in fact, at one time I was not able to do even my, you know, daily routine. So one side fighting on the top of these peaks and then not able to do your daily routine also was a, you know, something. But then life goes on, and I always believe that, you know, there is some opportunity in every adverse situation, right? I take a motivation out of it, strength out of it. So from my hospital bed, I started preparing for my MBA. Because of my medical injury, I had to move out of the army. But then I say that's giving me a next opportunity. In fact, I cleared some of the top MBA exams in the country and did my MBA from FMS Delhi with a gold medal. Moved to corporate, did quite well. And for last 14 years, I'm with Tata Group. I'm vice president and looking after their global service delivery and operation. So one good thing is I'm working with a group which is equally good in terms of ethics and value system. You know, I don't have to compromise my value system and my ethics working for this group. So, you know, that gives me a lot of sense of achievement and alignment while working for a group like Tata, which is totally pro-nation and, you know, looking after these value system. Second, on my personal front, my value system has not changed. Only thing, even if I have taken the uniform, so me and my wife both, still we are inspiring, you know, our youth, our next generation. We do take off so many motivational lectures, so many things, the leadership which we can learn from the battlefield, right? You can learn something from my MBA books, but this is nothing in compared what life has taught you on the battlefield where your life was at stake. So we continue to inspire this, and I spent my personally lot of time in terms of, you know, telling the young generation, telling the nation that, you know, what sacrifices were made and how costly the freedom is.
On the occasion of Kargil Vijay Diwas, what would be your message to our fellow countrymen?
Okay, I think that's a very important question. See, what we think when there is no war, you know, there may not be need of any army, and most of us just forget, like, we remember our army and God only at the time of difficulty. But I just wanted to say one thing, freedom is not free, right? Somebody is paying in his blood with his life today also at different border. You see what's happening at China border, you see what's happening on Pakistan, and what you see what's happening in Kashmir every day in terms of terrorism, right? So this freedom what we are enjoying, we just take it for granted. Just wanted to tell everyone that this is not free. Somebody is paying for our freedom. Somebody is paying so that we can sleep peacefully, and we have got confidence that nothing will happen to us till the time our army is guarding our borders. So we need to have that kind of, you know, gratitude. We need to ensure that, you know, country is being protected. But we only see one side. We always see the pride of victory, right? We celebrate our victory. We have seen so many things. We do not see the pain. We do not see the pain of families which go through. We do not see the pain of disabled soldier which is happening, right? In fact, we decided to do something about it. My wife is writing a book, Pride and Pain, on the Kargil side, right? We see the pride side, you know, we are bringing pride to the nation. But then she's also trying to show from her personal journey what are the pain which families goes through. You know, somebody father is not there. Somebody brother is not there. Somebody's son died in the thing. I'm staying in a society, Kargil society, where, you know, there are ladies who lost their husband, right? Small children lost their father. You know, parents have lost their son. What is the pain which they go through? So victory is over, but the pain is gone for a long time. So we need to understand what is this pain and have some gratitude for all those who are, you know, putting their life at stake. And I just want to close with just one quote, which is a Fauji, a army man, he does not fight or put his life at stake because he hates his enemy. No, he even doesn't know him. Who is the enemy, right? It may be another soldier doing his duty. He doesn't know him. Why he fight and ready to sacrifice his life? Because he loves his country. He loves his countrymen. And that's what he is ready to sacrifice anything. So Jai Hind, that's the message I just want to give it.